This week on Maker Update, making your own 3D printed computer museum, Fusion 360 learns a new trick, a smoking laser sword, a new drawbot, a reason to buy a dental Vacuform, and a giveaway for a full Raspberry Pi computer setup from WD Labs. It's Wednesday, December 7th. I'm Donald Bell, and welcome to another episode of Maker Update. I'm going to try something new this week. I found a lot of cool things to include in the show, and instead of tossing half of them out to keep things really tight, I'm going to leave them in. This is going to be the floppy episode, all right? It's just going to be loose. Let me know what you think. Let me know if you're into it. But I will keep with the tradition of starting things off with the project of the week. This week, over on Adafruit, the Ruiz brothers, Noah and Pedro, have a great tutorial on making this mini reproduction of the Commodore PET. Making its debut in 1977, the PET is considered the first personal computer ever available for retail customers. This version is essentially a 3D printed shell for an Adafruit featherboard with a 16x9 matrix of LEDs on top. All in, the electronics will set you back around $42. The print comes in about 10 pieces, requiring only a few dollars of filament to print out. If you don't have a 3D printer, ordering the design printed on 3D hubs comes to around $30 shipped, from what I found. Just the 3D print itself would be fun, but what I like about this project is that it's a great excuse to dip your toe into the Arduino-compatible Adafruit featherboards. I've heard a lot of great things about them, but I just haven't had a project yet that could take advantage of their small size and power and their ecosystem of cool little shields like the LED matrix. But I want this. I also like that the code that animates the screen is written by Phil Burgess, whose work on Adafruit I really enjoy. The animation cycles between typing code, Conway's Game of Life, the Matrix effect, and a blank screen with a little blinking cursor. If you'd rather lock it into just one or two of those, the code makes it really clear what to do. If you want to roll your own graphics, the Adafruit graphics library for Arduino has some great examples of what you can do. And when you're all done, you get this neat little rechargeable vintage computer reproduction that you can keep on your desk, just in case anyone has any doubts about what a geek you are. While you're at it, over on Thingiverse, there's an amazing collection of other mini vintage computer designs, Atari, Amiga, the Trash 80, Apple IIc. Some of them are super tiny, but a few of them look like they could be adapted to a similar LED matrix retrofit if your Commodore PET gets lonely. And now for news. Last week, Autodesk showed off an unreleased version of their Fusion 360 3D design software that seamlessly integrates Eagle CAD's printed circuit board design software. It's not a huge surprise considering that Autodesk bought up Eagle CAD's parent company CADsoft back in June, but it's the first we've seen how the capabilities of both programs might work together. In the demo video, you can see how the designer was able to zoom in from the design to the board, adjust the placement of a mounting hole, and then automatically reroute the circuit traces and pull back out. It's a neat trick, though arguably the same designer designing the vehicle isn't the one tweaking the circuit design, or shouldn't be. But from an organizational perspective, I can see the appeal of having your whole team plugged into one piece of software that does it all and tracks changes all in one place. Like I said though, this is just a preview and I don't believe Autodesk has put a date on when we'll actually see this. Speaking of Autodesk, this past Friday, I got to go to the Artist in Residence Showcase at Autodesk Pier 9 Mega Workshop, which is also the home of Instructables. I saw some amazing projects, including a 3D printer that prints glass, and the Vote With Your Feet project I mentioned back in episode 8, the one with the flip dots. Best of all, I got to catch up with Scott McIndoe, whose projects I've geeked out on across multiple episodes of this show, and I'm about to do it again. All of Scott's projects were on display, including the laser-cut topographic maps from episode 5, the orbiting time-lapse rig, the warping infinity mirror, and the new projects that Scott's published on Instructables, such as the black hole table, a gorgeous periodic table lamp, and this solar Analemma chandelier that tracks the position of the sun over the course of a year. I'll include links to these new projects, but to talk about them and to do them any justice would take a whole other episode. I will say this though, one project of Scott's that really drew a crowd and isn't yet on Instructables at the time I'm recording this is this lightsaber, which I'm sure for legal reasons Scott will have to call a laser sword or something. It's a 3D printed hilt that incorporates 12 red laser pointer lasers and an e-cig vaporizer just like his portable fog machine from episode 8. It's non-lethal, and I can't imagine it's too expensive to build, probably not much more than the $80 or so it costs to build that portable fog machine. When Scott gets the instructions up, expect to see this again in an upcoming show. I have a lot of cool tools and tips to share with you this week. The first is this new and improved AxiDraw version 3 from Evil Mad Scientist Laboratories. This is a $475 computer-controlled pen plotter designed to just lay right on top of whatever you want it to draw on. It looks like a lot of fun, and this version runs twice as fast as the previous generation. Over on Adafruit, they've got two new Arduino-compatible distance sensors that use a unique time-of-flight sensor that shoots out a tiny laser and looks to see how long it takes to reflect back. This makes it more narrow and specific than an ultrasonic sensor and more precise than an IR sensor. It's also super small and comes in two flavors. One that measures motion close up, around 5 to 200 millimeters, and one that looks a little further out, between 50 and 1200 millimeters. They're $14 and $15 respectively. Here's a cool trick from one of my favorite makers, Ben Light, who took a $100 Vacuform machine, typically used for molding dental impressions, and used it to form custom enclosures for his handmade circuits. It looks really cool. The thin plastic sheets cost just pennies. You can paint it, you can cut away any openings with a razor blade. I think it's an awesome technique for enclosing your prototype boards, so way to go, Ben. I've got a link to the machine that Ben used in the show notes if you want to give it a try. Finally, if you've ever wanted to configure a Raspberry Pi so that it just plays a loop of videos, maybe for a museum installation or for an office waiting room, the Adafruit blog has pointed me to the mp4museum.org project, which does exactly that. This is just an SD card image pre-configured to play any videos on an attached USB drive in alphabetical order. And that's all it does. It boots up and automatically plays through the videos on loop until you turn it off. And now you know. Speaking of Raspberry Pi, this week's show is sponsored again by WD Labs, the Raspberry Pi-obsessed division of Western Digital. They've got three new products out that I genuinely think you guys are going to be interested in. The first is called the WD PIDRIVE Node Zero. It's a Raspberry Pi Zero fit onto a 314-gig hard drive using an adapter that offers up two full-size USB ports. Altogether, the whole thing is $44.95 and comes with a microSD card pre-installed with a custom version of Noobs that runs the OS from the hard drive. The second product is called the WD Smart Cable Module. It's an adapter for the Raspberry Pi Compute Module that includes two USB ports, an Ethernet jack, 802.11 BGN Wi-Fi, and a multi-function push button. It's $24.95 and you have to supply your own module and power adapter, but I've never seen anything like it. It's like a full Raspberry Pi, but in a slimmer oval form. The third is called the WD PIDRIVE Compute Center. It's a Pi 3, a 375GB hard drive, a case, a wireless keyboard, wireless mouse, drive cable, preloaded microSD card, and power supply. You connect this right up to your TV or monitor, and you've got everything you need to start playing with Raspberry Pi right out of the box. They sell the whole package, Pi included, for $109.99. And the really great news is that I'm giving away one of these PIDRIVE compute centers. All I need from you is your best idea for a Raspberry Pi project that you want to try. It doesn't have to be an original idea, just share with me a Raspberry Pi project that you're itching to do, include some relevant links, and a convincing plea so that I feel good about sending you a $110 Raspberry Pi setup instead of just keeping it for myself. The winner will be whoever I think has the coolest, most interesting idea that I honestly think they want to pull off. So email me your ideas. I'm donald@makerprojectlab.com. I'm going to pick a winner in 1 week. You just get 1 week. But all I'm asking for is just an email of an idea, right? So just do it now. I'll also pick four runners up who will get a PIDRIVE kit to give their Pi projects more storage. The other cool thing about the PIDRIVE system, which also comes with the compute center, is that you can set it up to automatically have five partitions that they call project spaces. So instead of having multiple projects stored on little micro SD cards that you have to swap out and keep track of, you can juggle between multiple projects or setups using just one drive. I think that's pretty cool. Okay? So email me your project ideas. I know almost all of you have some Raspberry Pi project bookmarked somewhere that you're just waiting to get to. Now's your chance. Or go scour Instructables or Hackaday or Make or Magpie. Just find your idea, email me, donald@makerprojectlab.com, and help me show our sponsor, WD Labs that my audience is an audience of really cool people who have great ideas and that they're a smart company for sponsoring the show, okay? Maker Faires. There's one left in 2016 and it's this weekend in Bogotá, Colombia. If anyone's watching this in Bogotá, let me know how it went. Send me an email or leave a comment. All right, and that's it for this week's show. I want to encourage all of you out there to stay safe, okay? I don't know how to talk about the Oakland tragedy without crying, so I'm not going to. But I do want to let you know I found some time this past weekend to get my fire extinguisher up off the floor, mounted onto a wall, and showed my kid how to use it. And I encourage all of you this week to find some time to make your homes and your workspaces safer. Okay? That's it. And thanks for watching. I'll see you next week.